just like that there. It was quite an endeavour to get out there and play again. You know, get the old blisters back and everything, you know. It was quite a surprise. We're all running around with sore necks this morning and everything.
And did you find out, like, with the audience there, that they knew a lot of the stuff from the past?
We were very, very surprised, in fact, because we thought after the 2 years lapse that they would have forgotten, you know, quite a lot of the material, but nothing like that at all last night. You know, it was great. It gave Keith a chance because he was sweating it out last night with so many people being there. You kind of sit back and let them take over. And it was great. We really enjoyed it. A great way to start the tour again.
And you had a good time as well, Keith, yeah?
Fantastic, yeah. Obviously, you know, apprehensions about joining a band that already had a big following and stuff, but everybody made me feel really welcome, and we had a really good time, yeah.
Right, so tomorrow it's Horns in Tralee, and then it's the rest of Ireland all next week. Okay, well, listen, let's get down to the real business as to why you're here now. So, Pat, take that off that speaker over there.
Indeed,
and give us the match. See, we've had many bands in the studio before playing music and all the rest of it, as you all know, but this time around we have a sort of a harder rocker band in the studio doing it, but what are they going to do for us? Take it away.
Here we go. Are you right, Keith?
Yeah.
Right.
Say is your parents must have wondered where they went wrong. Long-haired louts in a heavy rock band, you know. It's 5 years, is it?
Maybe more, even.
But for those people who don't know that, like, I mean, Mama's Boys as a hard rock band to Mama's Boys, as you've just heard there now, you were Irish junior champions for
a few
years. How long ago was that now, Pat?
When I was 11.
God, years ago.
Years ago. I'm not giving away my age, though, now.
So what does it mean, Irish junior champions? Who? Like the three McManus brothers?
Yeah. We used to go in, you used to go all the flag carols and everything else like that there, and you have these competitions. There was a big revival in the late 60s, early 70s of the Irish traditional scene, and we were all part of that because we grew up in the countryside in Ireland, so there was always music around us, and especially Irish music, you know. We never listened to the pop music or anything else that was going on in the rest of the world. It was just, we had this circle that we kept visiting. It was like one house tonight and somebody else's house tomorrow night. It was like one continuous party. But we learned all our tunes and songs from there. And then my grandmother was very much in traditional Irish songs. And my father played a lot of Irish music, so he handed it down to us. It wasn't something that was forced upon us.
Mm. Well, did it get a bit more serious then when you realised you could win competitions with this sort of thing?
Not at all. It was purely for the fun of it. You know, I think Irish music, there's a lot of fun aspect in it, you know, and you could get off. It meant you get off for a weekend to Listowel, and everybody went mad, you know. There was out in the streets, in pubs, in chapels.
It's quite sad, actually, to see it having, you know, faded away so much, because I remember back then, when you go to the Flack Hills, you could get anything, maybe up to 40,000 to 50,000 people from all over the world there, Germans, French, Americans, and everybody, you know, partaking in the day. And that's, you know, that scene is completely gone now. I've actually been to a flag kill recently that was on in, I think, in Ballyshannon, and there was nothing there, you know.
Do you mean, like, to use that horrible phrase, the young people of Ireland are not sort of getting involved in this sort of thing anymore?
Yeah, exactly.
And is that the all-pervasive sort of Radio 2 pop music, the Sky channels late at night, and just too much pop,
I just think
too
there's
easy?
Too much distraction, you know, because when we were younger, you know, there was no televisions or anything else, you know, and we had to sort of entertain ourselves. And it was great, it really was, and it's nice to keep the tradition alive, you know, but it's a shame, it seems to just sort of been straying away again. Maybe it will make a revival again, yeah. I don't know. But
so a lot less people around the age of 11 or 12 or 13 are playing the music?
Oh yeah, I think so, yeah. You know, I think so. Although it still goes on, but not to the same extent it was. Yeah. During then, you know.
Well, you were playing that music then for a long time, so what went wrong? You went to see Horselips?
I went to see Horselips, yeah. You know.
That was in Drumshambo.
In County Leitrim.
Yeah.
And when was that?
That was exactly...
78, I think it
78.
Was.
78. Yeah. It's almost 10, it's 9 years ago.
And you went to see, oh, sure, Horselips were well on by then.
we'd missed out on the early Horselips completely, you know. I think they had the Book of Invasions out at the time. And we went one night along and thought it was absolutely the best thing we'd ever seen in our lives. And I think due to the fact that we could relate to what they were doing, basically because, well, they played Irish music and we sort of understood that. If it had been Led Zeppelin, we'd said, forget it.
Yeah, right, I guess. So you were able to go the one extra step, which was the plugging in the instruments,
you know,
and making
we thought
it electric
the excitement and the energy they created. Yeah. We thought, well, we have to tap in on some of this, you know.
Yeah. So it must make you feel pretty good now to have Johnny Feen guesting on the album.
It was great. It really was.
Johnny was our hero.
Yeah.
You know, it was very, very strange to have him actually in there in the studio in London, playing, you know, the end of the Blacklisted, you know, it was fantastic, you know, to give that vibe. In fact, we just had said, you know, I think his solo suited the song perfect. It was exactly the kind of solo we needed to finish off that track, and I don't even think if Pat would have done it, it would have given that same vibe, you know.
Yeah.
And for us, it was
Johnny's
really
a great player, you know. Yeah. Every lick I ever learned, I copied off and ripped off every night. It was very funny because we used to go to the gigs everywhere. Like, I think they were embarrassed sometimes for seeing us there because we were there before them, you know. Four sound checks and everything. But the idea was, that I would get there to see what Johnny was up to. You see, so I would stand in front of the stage every night, right? And I would learn some of his licks, and what I would do then, I would drive home and try and remember them when I get back to the house, because
I read about these sort of things in the music papers. I never even believe these things happen.
Oh, it did happen.
Yeah. I've seen people, like, don't get me wrong.
And I used
I
to stand there just standing,
idiots sitting
watching
sorry,
them, you know, and I'd remember that riff, you know, and I'd run home, but I could get maybe some of it, and I couldn't get the rest of it, so I would have to go back the next night to get the rest of it. And what would happen sometimes in between things, the bit that I was waiting for, somebody would distract me, and I would miss it. So it meant going back again another night, you know. But that's how I learned the guitar.
Fair play to you, Pat. What about you, Keith? Where did you learn it?
Well, my experience of traditional Irish music comes from about 5 minutes just before we started. But as far as getting into bands and stuff, you know, it came when I was sort of at school and stuff. I learned to play a bit of guitar and a bit of fiddle and a bit of this, but nothing serious until we actually got a band together, and then it was the usual thing doing the pubs and club circuits, you know. But I found that in those days, you didn't really get to see many bands because, you know, you're out in the suburbs, and it was a big thing to go sort of up to London to someone like Hammersmith or that.
And how far were you from London?
Not that far, really. I mean, we're only talking about a matter of 11, 12, 15 miles, which sounds ridiculous probably to people around here, but when you're out in the suburbs and that, you know, the only bands that would come to those sort of places would be like club bands or show bands and that, you know. You wouldn't actually get in to see like a rock band unless you went into London. Mm-hmm. And it was a while after that before I started actually going to gigs and festivals and stuff, you know. But the bands that, you know, that I was really into was always like sort of blues-based bands like Free, Bad Company, bands like that. So I think that's where the marriage, if you like, of me and the guys has really come together, because there's a lot of similarities in the way chord structures and everything with the blues thing and the Irish traditional thing, you know.
Yeah.
So we found that it's been really easy to work together because it seems like, you know, we've all come from the same place, even though we haven't.
Well, you were in a band before Mama's Boys.
I was indeed.
What kind of fame? What was the name of the band, first of all?
The name was Air Race.
So with Air Race, then, who would be known, like, say, to a lot of, say, Kerrang readers, but not necessarily too much outside of that. Yeah. I mean, like, what kind of things did you do? Did you learn your trade there, sort of touring with the big bands or anything?
Yeah, we toured with bands like Queen and Def Leppard, Meatloaf, Ted Nugent, people like that. We didn't really do as much touring as we could have. We did a load of clubs and stuff on our own in Britain. We never, unfortunately, got to anywhere like Ireland or that. And we never actually got to play in America, although we did actually go to America to record the album.
Mm.
And most success that we did have with the record was in America, because it was that sort of sounding band, you know.
So what happened to the band? Did you leave, or is it broken up?
No, it's broken up. You know, as with many bands, one problem that Mama's Boys haven't got is that you normally get one person in the band who can't be controlled and gets a bit too big for their boots. It happens with so many bands.
Too big for their boots, ego, or too big for their boots, taking substances that are not good for you?
No, egos, really. I mean, it's the worst thing. I mean, people talk about drink and drugs being a problem with rock bands, but egos is the biggest problem that ever comes into any band and that splits any bands up, you know? Yeah. And unfortunately, that was part of the Air Race thing, and it just couldn't hold together any longer, so it split up eventually.
Yeah. Okay, well, I'm going to talk about America to the other two, because you have been there and you have toured there. But before I do, I think I'll play some other Mama's Boys music, just in case the fans are saying, what the hell is going on out there? They've got some instruments with them and they're going to play us a tune now. So maybe, Pat, you tell us what this is and then do it.
I haven't a clue. Like so many Irish tunes, you just play them.
Oh, well, go ahead, be it then. Normally guitar and bass, this time guitar and whistle, John and Pat McManus, very good indeed. Okay, let me see, there's one other McManus missing, of course, a power trio is what Mama's Boys have always been known as, and now Keith's messed that one up anyway. So tell us about Tommy, how's the illness treating him these days? I believe he's okay.
He's what they call on the technical term remission, you know, so it means that he's totally back in the right direction again, you know. It was a bit of a shock to us because... Well, he had it from he was 9 years old, right? It was nothing new, really. To
what us. Was it? A weird sort of form of leukemia. Leukemia.
It's a very rare form of leukemia, you know, which is it means that he has to go through chemotherapy and radiation. Yeah. You name it. He's suffered a lot, you know, and it's been through a hell of a time. And it's
so remarkable. What happened in the early days was he attended hospital in Belfast for about 5 years, and after treatment they got him into remission. And he actually can carry. What can happen is you go into 5 years of remission, right? And it may, you know, he may have a relapse again. But of course, you know, with the 5 years having gone past and him having grown up to be really big, you know, we never expected, you know, for 1 minute that it would ever come back again. And coming towards the end of our 85 tour
in America,
yes, he began, his whole body began to ache and feel very, very sore. And of course, you know, we never thought anything of it. We just thought it was maybe the tour, you know, that was making him feel very tired and everything else, because it was a very long tour. And when we came back home off that tour, we brought him back down to the hospital, and thank God it was in the very, very early stages of it again, and they were able to treat it, you know. But having said that, you know, even though he did go through months of treatment and got him back in remission again, he came out of hospital before he should have, because he wanted to do the Irish tour. And we did a Milton Keynes festival with Marillion and two in Germany. And he came out and he had a relapse after that, and we were sure that we were going to lose him, because I spent a lot of time with him in the Royal Victoria Hospital in Belfast, and I've never seen him so low before, you know. But, you know, it got to the stage where he couldn't even eat, he couldn't even get out of bed, because, you know, been lying on his back for so many days, you know, on a drip or whatever, he couldn't eat, couldn't move or anything else, you know. But sheer willpower, I think, pulled him through in the end, and the want to get back out on the road again, brought him through it.
So how was he last night, whacking away at the back of his head?
You would not believe it. I mean, a lot of people can't actually believe that it's him, because he's monstrous. I mean, he's huge, you know. I mean, he's looking down at us, and he's the youngest. He's still only 21.
Yeah.
And he's in really good form. But this time, I think he kind of left it very hard on himself, because he was, you know, he's the type that likes to go out partying after a show or whatever. And, you know, whenever we were in bed, sort of, you know, trying to get in as many hours sleep possible, he was out, you know, going around the clubs or whatever, you know. But he's trying to take it a little bit easier this time, kind of. You know.
Well, this is a really hypothetical question, but just one last thing about Tommy. It's probably a ridiculous thing to ask. If he wasn't in Mama's Boys, if you didn't have this lure of the road and the albums and all the rest of it, if he was, say, just back up at home and doing whatever, do you think he would have pulled through his...
No.
That's what did it for him, in other words.
I'm convinced that's what did it for him. Absolutely, the power of rock and roll.
You're not going to... Yeah. This is a really funny thing, actually. When we had to finish off a European tour, right? So we took in this guy called Jim Del Grosso, who's now playing with a band called Y&T. But he did some work with Ozzy Osbourne on his last album, on the early stages of the demo tapes. And Chris Tangarides, who produced two of our previous albums, told us about him and said, you know, why don't you give him a ring? Because Tommy couldn't do the tour. But, you know, we kept in contact with him throughout that tour and kept ringing from France and saying, how you doing? He says, look, I'm in really good form and I want to do the Irish tour, so send Jim home. So what he did to try and get back into form again is he bought himself a little tiny drum kit in Belfast that consisted of a snare drum, one tom-tom and a bass drum.
In the hospital
24
hours a day,
and the doctors actually gave him a room where he could practice.
I couldn't believe it
when I heard it. He says, I'm practicing. I says, how can you be practicing? He says, I'm in a little room here. He says, with a, you know, a few toms and I'm going for it, you know. But that was, you know, the sheer want of wanting to get back on the road again, you know. Yeah. It was incredible.
So it was very good that he was in a rock and roll band.
Yeah,
was
definitely.
Discovered,
yeah.
Okay, well, tell me one thing then. We're going to go back to... Keith mentioned his experiences, or he mentioned America not really getting there properly, but you have been there. Mm-hmm. So tell us about the bands you played with. Like, you played with Bon Jovi and Rush and Rat and Twisted Sister. Now, were they all in the States?
Oh, yeah, all in the States, yeah.
So what kind of places were these? Were these big festivals or what?
It's amazing, you know. Like, it was... the way they work in America is it's usually a three-band bill. You know, you would start off with... Rat would be headline, and Bon Jovi were second in... on the bill, and we were the openers, you know. So we had the dirty job to do, as we always say, you know. But you'd be playing for anywhere between 20,000-25,000 people. And the way it works in America, it's not, you can't buy on to a tour. They actually have to see that you're selling tickets, that you're on MTV, that you're getting radio play, and that's what they really go for. It's not a case of giving a young band exposure. You won't get exposure unless you're actually happening on those things.
So, well, what about the headline band who say, listen, I know this little band from Ireland sort of thing or something, and
they're not really interested. All they're interested in is you're selling tickets.
Really?
Because some of those bands haven't enough drawn power to actually fill out a place like that. So
I'll give you an example. One of the bands that we toured with in 1984 was a band called Rat, and they just sold over 3 million copies.
of their Out of the Cellar album.
Yeah.
And yet they were coming in to do 10,000 seat arenas and they couldn't sell them out.
Mm.
You know, which left it very hard on us, because had they been selling out, we could have finished off the rest of the tour. But as it happens, they had to take Bon Jovi in. This was before they made it really big, and they were second on the bill, and then they began to sell out.
You know, so it was, it's a sort of a combination of those getting a three-act day. It's more like a...
Yeah, I know what you mean.
So like, they can sell out these places. So
like
it's a
the
bit weird.
The old-fashioned days of a package, like the Beatles and Billy J. Kramer and Petula Clark or something on the one bill.
Exactly, you know.
But, so tell us then, like, I mean, does that mean that you have got, in that great phrase of American rock television, a heavy rotation on MTV?
Oh, yeah.
Well, at the minute...
Like, Mama We're All Crazy was a good hit. But, I mean, hadn't another band got that?
There was a lot of, actually... aggro over that.
I'd say that was. That was the old Slade one, right? And both bands at the same time, right?
Yeah.
And we saw it an awful lot over here.
Yeah.
On
it did get great exposure
USA.
Over there.
It was on MTV an awful lot, because that's when I was over in New York doing the Air Ace album. And you know, I knew a bit about Mama's Boys, but not a lot. And there they were four or five times a day coming on MTV.
So would that have been one of the great things that helped
you? Oh, that was without a doubt one of the biggest breaks we got in that area. But it was strange, because Quiet Riot had heard we were doing it, and they rush released it, and they were after selling 6 million albums of their previous album, and they went to MTV and sort of blackmailed them and said, look, we'll give you an exclusive if you cut these boys off. They're upset that we did this.
And they could afford to have a huge campaign with 6 million set up behind
them. Who are radio stations not going to argue with them, because they'd already sold 6 million. They were a viable product at that stage. And we were so close to it, and yet we were sort of...
Well, did you do any gigs in the States around 84, 85 by yourselves?
Yes, we did. Yeah. It's very, very strange, but it always seems to happen for Irish bands. But we have a fairly reasonably good name in Texas, you know, and even Rory Gallagher can do, you know, good business in Texas, and even Thin Lizzy, where they weren't known throughout the rest of the United States, they could actually, you know...
Texas being three or four times the size of Ireland anyway.
Yeah. You know, on our last tour in America, we actually went out there and headlined, you know, for about 2 weeks before we joined up with Rat, and we're selling out places like the same size as the SFX in Texas. Yeah. And it was really good. You know, we're very, very surprised the album took off down there.
Yeah.
And, but as regards to the rest of America, we actually have to go out and work with somebody else.
Well, before you talk, why did you take in Keith, by the way? I mean, no disrespect to Keith who's sitting here with us, but what was wrong with the voice?
Well, again, that last tour that we done started in the beginning of January 1984, and we finished in January 1985. And normally the way you work a tour is you do three nights on and one night off. And that was pretty good, you know, I was holding up throughout all of the tour until we came to Europe, and we finished off doing 20 concerts back to back, which is unheard of, really. And my voice collapsed halfway through. That was just before we came into Ireland, and I was very upset because I wanted to be in top voice for doing the shows over here. And so it meant we had to try and get a throat specialist on the road with us to look after my voice. And he said it was the worst damaged throat he'd ever seen. And if I didn't actually take a break or get some sort of help out, he'd maybe even stand a chance of losing my speaking voice. So I think we always kind of felt that we needed a fourth member in the band, because it was very hard on the three of us. You know, if we had a bad night or whatever, it always hit the three of us, you know, it didn't affect just one person, you know.
Mm.
So it's much easier now, at least if we have a bad night, you know, there's somebody else, we can blame Keith or whatever. You know.
Do you play as well, Keith?
I just play a bit, but certainly not enough to actually want to get up on stage.
So are you two happier then with the way it is now?
Oh, yeah,
definitely, yeah.
You know, and it's so much easier on us now, because there was a lot of pressure on, being three brothers and all, it was serious. Like, some of the festivals we did were huge, you know. Like, I remember one instance, we were in Tulsa, Oklahoma, playing with Rat. And we flew from there to New York, where we got a plane from there to Nebworth, where we played with Deep Purple in front of 80,000 people.
Mm.
And the next day at 2 o'clock, we were headlining in Minneapolis with Iron Maiden.
Rock and roll.
Yeah, you know, and it was that kind of pressure, you know, and John Voight just caved in, and there was an awful lot of pressure on us.
Yeah. And being the only singer in the band as well, you know, had Pappy Nibble been a singer, or even Tommy, it wouldn't have been so bad, but I had to, you know, keep up.
Does that mean now, John, that you sort of hang out a bit and do a bit of singing at
all? I just do the BVs, basically. That's about the height of it, you know. I'd much prefer to just sit back and let Keith do it, because I'd be quite embarrassed, in fact, to try and sing in front of him.
Yeah.
And it's very hard, being a power trio, to create a big sound, you know.
And now you can really concentrate.
And now I can turn down my guitar.
What about keyboards incidentally? Because Phil Begley, the producer of the album, he plays keyboards on the album.
I've always had a passion for keyboards. I just love them. Really.
Mama's Boys in keyboards, shock.
Yeah, no, love them, always. You know? And the songs took on a completely different, they happened completely different because of the fact that Tommy wasn't around at the time, and we were sort of sitting around, and we had an outlet. Do I know it's a bit of a mercenary thing to say, but you know, you have commitments and you have contracts that you must oblige, and you must keep those contracts up. So we were left writing songs, you know, and we were sort of sitting listening to the charts, and you know, you get influenced in some ways, and plus the fact that the record company kept coming back to us and saying, we want a hit. Mm-hmm. We want a hit, you know, and you do everything in your power to try and create a hit. And some of the songs, I think, on the album in general, I think we tried too hard to have a hit, if you know what I mean. You know, whereas we just wanted to make an album.
Yeah, that's the usual,
Of how we felt and what we were trying to create, you know. But sometimes you just get so lost in what record companies are trying to do, and they push it so much down your throat, they need a hit to get this thing off the ground.
Well, in saying, like, in having a hit, then, I mean, if you have a song, you can make a hit, as you call it, or you make it sound hit-like or whatever, because you know what you're doing in the studios these days, as opposed to, say, it with the first album or so. Then you've gone back to your first producer now. Now, in between, you had this guy, Chris, with the ridiculously unpronounceable surname. Tangle Hairdo,
we call
it. And he did Thin Lizzy and Iron Maiden and all those. So did you learn enough from him in those middle...
Not to knock Chris at all. He comes from a totally different area from where we were coming from. And I think this new album is much closer to the earlier stuff without the lavish production.
I mean, even
production.
In terms of twiddling knobs and things, like you had got through the first two albums, say, and now you were like big time, if you like.
Yeah.
And I'm talking 82 to 84 here, those albums in between there. And I mean, like, do you not power
no,
and passion?
No, we look at them as a backward step for the band. Really? We look as if we wasted 2 years. That album should have come out when we got our record deal. That's the album we should have made then.
This
present album,
you know.
That's where we wanted to go. That's what we wanted to do. And unfortunately, we were caught up in that heavy metal thing that happened when that new explosion happened
British
again.
The new wave of heavy metal.
Yes, but when it happened in America again a few years ago.
Oh, yeah.
And all we got, again, we were a young band. We were after getting signed, and we were afraid to open our mouth to say, well, look, you know, we're artists. We're going to do it for the way we want to do it. And we didn't. We sort of kept our mouths shut and listened to what they had to do. And they sort of pushed us in that real heavy metal sort of Kiss type, chanty, anthem type band, which we weren't.
Yeah.
We were coming.
Well, then,
from...
where are you? I mean, like Keith mentioned earlier on, I mean, like, I know it's very unfair sometimes to pigeonhole, but Keith mentioned earlier on that you like the bluesier based of the hard rock side of earlier mid 70s, in other words, from Free right back around to Bad Company.
That's where we come from. That's where we're coming from. That's what I love.
So, in other words, you're not to be roped in with the people who put spanners down their trousers and long lurex hair and all the rest of it.
Well, if you're talking about bad news, no way. Although we think it's hilarious.
I think the thing that people get confused with, you know, is that they think that volume, you know, is energy, but the energy actually comes from within the music. You know, you don't have to really play something at you know, an unbearable volume before people can get up and start banging their heads and jumping around to it. If you've got that energy created in the music, which comes sort of from your soul, if you like, then you know, then that is what I call heavy. You know, it doesn't have to be loud to be heavy. Yeah. I mean, I think the new album is very heavy, but in a different sort of way.
But these days, if you're playing any sort of heavy music or any sort of hard rock music, it does seem to help in terms of getting to the very top, presuming you want to get to the top, although not necessarily without compromise. It does seem to help to really make it look as though you're going all the way with the funny-looking coloured hair and with everything else and with the...
That never was us. I don't think we could ever be that because we're from the countryside. It's not as if we came from part of London.
That's good an answer.
You know, we're country lads. That's not the way we grew up, you know.
Yeah,
all right. So we have no idea. I couldn't be like that, you know. So there's no point trying to be like that. Something you're not.
Non-gimmick.
Yeah. We just get out and play. It's a bit like the Rory syndrome. We just love to get up, tune up and play. That's all we wanted to do.
Yeah, we were talking about the Rory album earlier on. Do you like it? Yeah,
great.
It's brilliant, isn't it?
It's a really good album. Actually, we played for the very first time during Tommy's break, or when he was sick, we played in Germany with Rory, and it was the first time we ever actually even met him, you know.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
When was this?
It was last year.
Just after the Milton Keys concert with Marillion.
Yeah, Jethro Tull were on the bill, we were there, and Rory was there, and it was the first time in 15 years he was saying that he hadn't headlined in Germany, you know, and he was second on the bill to Jethro Tull, you know. And it was an absolute experience to see him up there. I couldn't believe it, you know, to see the man himself. It was fabulous.
Was great, all right, yeah. The last time I saw him, I was at the Self-Aid gig, which was May of 76, or of 86.
Yeah.
Anyway, will we play a song here, or what do we do? Will we take a break or play a song? No, we'll play a song from the boys. Okay, have you got anything else there? I'm not going to play one of these, no. You're going to have to do something.
Oh, we're going to have to do something else.
Do something live. Have you got anything going there? No?
John has something here.
Come on, John, take out the whistle, for God's sake. Thank you. Keith, you were talking earlier on, we're coming up towards, well, no, not actually, we're 7 minutes away from the news. Yes, you were talking earlier on about Cliff. You toured with Cliff for a year. Well, I mean, you were there with Cliff for a year.
Well, I worked in...
As in Cliff Richard, incidentally.
Yeah, I worked in the musical Time, which was on the Dominion in London, and I did that for, well, I've been doing that up until I got involved with the guys. And then Cliff asked me to actually go on tour with his band, join the band and everything, you know. So I went and did a gospel tour, which was of Britain. And then after that, he was going to Europe and Australia, and unfortunately I couldn't go because the Mama's Boys thing came up.
So what's he like?
Great to work with. And he was one of the first people that were asking for a copy of the album when we'd finished it.
Yeah, very good.
And he's got one.
So one thing we haven't mentioned yet, incidentally, is the dates, which is one of the reasons you're here. So last night it was Dundalk in the Fairways Hotel. So Mama's Boys tomorrow in Horan's in Tralee. On Tuesday, it's Sir Henry's in Cork. Wednesday, the SFX in Dublin. Thursday, October 29th, it's next Thursday, Whitla Hall, Belfast. This day week, that's Friday, it's Knocknamore in Oma. And then there's two more, Lisnaskee in Artane Castle on Saturday week, that's tomorrow week. And then on Sunday week, that's November the 1st, it's in Drumsill House in Armagh. Is that right?
That's all it. Those?
Great. Very good. That's the tour.
So there's one other thing as well, and that is that before you came in, Keith, there was another vocalist that you had auditioned and was a member of the band, is that right? No? Am I wrong?
Yes, that's correct, yeah.
Rick Chase.
From Birmingham, by the name of Rick Chase. Rick was very, very good. We spent an awful long time actually looking for a singer. And
what did you do? You put an ad in the paper saying, band, looking for a singer, just
simple. Right, yeah, and we got these demos from all over the world.
You never heard anything negative.
But what did you say in the ad? Did you say Mama's Boys?
No,
we didn't. Yeah.
Just
no.
Said, you know, band with a record deal. That's as much as we give away, you
right,
know.
Right, yeah.
And we got from America, Holland, Germany, France, Italy, Spain, and there was really some very funny ones, you know, you just crack up, you know. There was a guy gave his rendition of Stairway to Heaven on an acoustic guitar, which he recorded in his room.
I'd love to hear that.
And he did the whole thing. He did the acoustic bits, drum bits, the John Bonham bits, the Jimmy Page solo, all on the acoustic guitar. I think I have that tape. We kept it for prosperity. It was very funny. In fact, it was despairing at times, you know. We'll run around pulling our hair out.
And then what happened? So you got Keith.
The strange
or
thing,
Rick, I mean.
Very, very weird, in fact, because when we did the demos throughout 1986, because Keith was, or Rick was very unfamiliar with the songs, we kind of said, well, you know, they are new songs to him, and the demos aren't that bad, so maybe when he, you know, lives with the tracks for a little while and we go in then to finally do the album, you know, it'll be a lot better. He had great clarity and a great quality, you know, and had a lot of distinction in his voice. But unfortunately, when it came to the time of recording the album, he couldn't even come near, you know, to what the demo sounded like. And then he ran into exactly the same kind of trouble as I did with the...
He had to develop the nodes, wasn't it?
Nodes, yeah.
On his voice. So we packed him off to holiday.
On a
holiday to Spain to see if we'd get the whole thing cleared up. And while he was away in Spain, I did the door to him. Found Keith.
Yeah.
Wow. I hope he's not listening.
It was very... It was a dreadful time because up until Christmas, the band were way under budget in the studios. And it was, in fact, in Dublin here, we were doing the vocals. And you know, each day we come into the studio, because having worked every day and come out of the studio at the end, you know, having done a lot of work, kind of the vocals, we weren't getting anything done. And you had the record company kind of saying, you know, well, what's happening, you know? 2 weeks, you know, in the studio, which is very, very expensive, and putting nothing down had finally to come to an end.
You know, so it was very funny, because we needed an extra multi-track machine over from England. It was around the Christmas period, and the guy who brought over the multi-track machine asked me how the album was going, and I came out honestly and said, look, you know, it's absolute rubbish. And he says, why? You know, because he'd heard the album, part of it that we recorded in London, and he thought it was very good. And he suddenly said, he was a brother of Nick Haywood's, Pete Haywood, and he says, I know a really good singer, you know. I told him what happened, you know, and he put me in contact with Keith. Simple as that. It was just word of mouth, really. If he hadn't arrived at the multi-track, we'd have never found it.
Yeah. So with these dates here that we have for the next week, what happens after that with Mama's Boys then? Where are you
we do the story in London, and then that's on the 3rd of November, and then we do a few dates up and down England. That's the bider time until we head off to the States. And then we're off to the States on the 15th in November.
And what kind of things is it for the States?
Well, it's time? Looking like we're going out with Rush out there. You know?
Rush,
yeah,
they're doing very well again. It's like a sort of a resurgence.
That's correct, indeed. You know, but they've never lost that.
No, yet. I suppose that's true.
You
as
know,
well,
we worked for them pages. Before, you know, and it was amazing. You know, it's 15,000-20,000 seaters every night.
Really?
Yeah, and it doesn't matter whether the record does well or not.
it's just that cult.
They just go out
on
that.
What you mean, yeah.
Yeah, they just go out on tour and that's it. Yeah. And it was great for us. So we at least we know them and we know how to. They're nice guys to get on.
Yeah.
So at least we can get out there and give our best.
Okay, well, listen, we're coming towards a break and then the news. So Pat and John and Keith as well and Tommy, if he's is Tommy listening, do you know?
No, he will be. Yeah,
we will indeed.
Listen, the four of you have a very good time in Ireland over the next week because it's hard work from there on out.
Well, thanks
hard
for
work.
Having us.
What am I talking about? Okay, enjoy yourselves and thanks for dropping in. Let's take a break. Three things. Number one. Thanks to Neil Toner for the loan of the fiddles. They could play it here in the studio. Number two, the dates. That's Horan's in Tralee. Mama's Boys will play tomorrow. And then next week, it's Tuesday, Sir Henry's Cork. Wednesday, SFX Dublin. Thursday, Whitla Hall, Belfast. Friday, Knocknamore and Oma. Saturday, that's tomorrow week, Artane Castle, Lisnaskee. And on Sunday week, November the 1st, it's Drumsill House in Armagh. And the third and final thing is, I'm going to play a track from the current album. And let's see if you recognise this. Even if you don't know Mama's Boys, you might know the track. That's a Stevie Wonder song, Higher Ground. That's the last track in side one of the current album from Mama's Boys, which is called Growing Up the Hard Way. And thanks to them for dropping into us in the studio tonight. Now, the other night I said I was going to play a track by John Hyatt later in the programme, and I forgot. He's playing at the Olympia.